concept of biodiversity hotspot. Concept of what called biodiversity hotspot. All is a solution. All is a solution at the international level. Concept of what called biodiversity hotspot is one of the solution to prevent loss of biodiversity. You know, this concept is totally based on two criteria. Then criteria are scientifically defined. Okay, these are some special. One is richness of biodiversity. First, work on the richness of biodiversity. First criteria is this. First criteria is based on what? Richness of biodiversity. They are rich in the living organisms. So, kya hai we? What is this? So that means the area must have what? How much?
Bulu.
Right? So what is the richness of biodiversity? They should be rich in biodiversity. So what is the criteria? How to find this area is rich or do not rich? So counting the species, by counting 1500 vascular plants. Count what? 1500 vascular plants. Once the criteria are important, just scientifically defined. First criteria, 1500 vascular plant. If in particular geography has to declare hotspot, so 1500 vascular plant or 0.5% of world biodiversity in terms of species, number of species, it can support endemic type. Which type? Criteria. That means endemic, you understand the word endemic, everyone? Indigenous. It cannot be transported or somewhere. Indigenous species of plants, animal, microorganism, whatever it is to the world, whatever the species are there together, it must around how much of that? Only 0.5% is there, then okay, it is rich. The world, but it's a very, very big number. Or another method is 1500. Vascular plant is there of endemic type, and that plant variety is not like numbers, it's like different varieties of 1500 vascular plant. That is the meaning. 1500 vascular plant variety are there. Or second criteria is on the certain threat criteria, threat to the loss, threat or to the loss of biodiversity, threat to the loss of what? Biodiversity is related to threat factors. First is it should be rich. Second, that is under danger zone. That is under which zone? Danger zone. That is called threat factor as well. So how to find out how much threat is, and is more threat, less threat and all. So if it is lost, already lost 70% of the natural habitat. So already lost, or not going to lost, already lost from the beginning till now, already lost what? Right, 70% of its natural habitat and their species. Geographical area has been degraded, deforested and fragmented, whatever it is. So only 30% is left out, or less. That area is threatened and it is still rich. 30% is still rich and it's a danger. That region is to be declared as what called biodiversity hotspot. That is called, this concept is given by one great ecologist called Norman Myers. We remember this ecologist name, Norman Myers has given this concept. This is biodiversity concept is given by whom? By an ecologist called Norman, N-O-R-M-A-N, Norman Myers. This concept was given by him. And this definition has been used by UN then later on. same definition is taken, accepted by whom? At international level. Even same definition, what has been given, defined by this guy, this man. So UN accepted this, and internationally, one biodiversity union has been established. And UN is sponsoring the fund and allocation, selection, allocating of money to, for protection and so now what this biodiversity hotspot need to be selected on which criteria is clear? How the biodiversity hotspot to be selected, the criteria is clear to everyone's mind. Now question is how to protect. Now second is, first is using the above criteria it is defined. Now question is how to protect such areas in biodiversity. Now the fund is allocated, area is been de- first approach is delimit and demarcate the selected area. Delimit and demarcate the region into three zones. How many zones? This is a perception. This is a concept. Is how to protect any ecosystem, and then it is applied in all ecosystems. So delimit and demarcate the region into three zones on the level of protection and conservation. First, second, and third. Three zones has been divided. The central region called as core. Central region is called as, it is used for all species protection. National parks, wildlife, sanctuaries, all kinds of this concept has been there. Tiger reserve, elephant reserve, this concept is there. Okay? This is the problem. First, the central region is called what? Core. Next is called the territorial region. Or, okay? Territorial zone. Or next. Or buffer zone. Third is called which zone? Core, territorial zone and buffer zone. You know. Ulta. Technically it's not possible. This is a buffer zone, this is called territorial zone. Now look at these objectives very clearly of protection. What are the objectives? And all these objectives of plant and animal or ecosystem protection work on this principle. First is, in the core area, the animal, plant, whosoever live should not be disturbed. And no one is permitted to visit that area. It is out of bound area for everyone. Even for the scientists, any for tourists, any for a development, any it is out of bound area. That area is called as what? Core region for protection. So that is first, the core region is what? First object of the core region is for entire protection and the conservation of natural ecosystem. The objective of core is to protect the natural habitat. So how the natural habitat has been protected? Look, in the core idea is to protect the natural habitat without human intervention of any kind. Without human interference of any kind. Without, that means even human is not authorized to visit for any purpose. It is illegal, out of bound area. Is it clear? So the central region where the plants, animals are protected, the objective is conservation in the natural habitat. So for there no human interference of any kind is permitted, without human interference of any kind. So that means it's no permissions are given to visit this. No permissions are given to anyone. And it is for illegal to do any kind of projects. Suppose you want to build a dam, you want to do agriculture. Any societies are there, suppose tribal people are living in the jungle and it is declared as what? Core area for tiger preservation. Or so kya karna chahiye? What is the best way? If this definition is there, what should the the people has to be removed and then destroyed. Or you have to, bondage would be like that, they will be not in that part. There's only two ways. If you put it inside, the only is to rehabilitate and resettle these people, the society. Or villages has been resettled. Is it clear? Or you just make the roads in such a manner, zigzag, so that village or the geography is away from the court. Okay, second part is the buffer zone. Second location is what called buffer zone. Buffer zone is a kind of buffer between the nature and the human. It's like a buffer between whom? The nature and the human. That is the technically the buffer zone, if the word is used. So, isme hota kya, you know, what happened here? So, aim is to study. Objective here was to protect the natural habitat, plant, animal, whatever it is. Here is to study the relationship. To study the relationship between man and environment properly, man and nature, or natural habitat. Now try to understand. Objective of the buffer zone is a what? Only who has been allowed. That means those who can study the relationship between man and natural habitat. Rest of the people and the project is not permitted in the buffer zone. So who is allowed here? Generally for the educational purpose and research purpose. Only allowed, only permissions are given. Only permissions. There was no permission for anyone. Even the scientists cannot visit them. So here only permission for what? For education and scientific purpose. Scientific research. The research could be kind of, so the point of research is that, okay, the jungle we are protecting, it is healthy or disease or increasing or decreasing, find out that. Second, even to find out human needs is getting fulfilled or not, find out relationship between man and the nature. So this is a location of nature, this is a location of man. It's a location of what's called man. To find out the relation, now, third zone is for sustainable development. Third zone is for what called sustainable relationship. Now, third is called which zone? Territorial zone. Territorial, the outermost part of the protected area or reserved area. They are called by different names. Territorial zone, okay, outermost part of the protected area, called as what? Territorial zone. It's called territorial zone. That's called territorial zone. So here, man can coexist. Man can coexist with what? Nature. But outsiders are not allowed. Try to understand, only for indigenous people or those who are living from at least from three generations. In the country, what is the law? What is forest laws, forest act of 2006 and 7 speak? Who can live in the territorial zones in the country is who are living from passed from many generations, at least from how many generations? Three generations. Last three generations they are living before the law is implemented. Before the law was implemented in India since 2006 and 7. This year, Forest Act India apply on this 2006 and again modified in 2007. Indian Forest Act, that's called Indian Forest Act. That is giving Forest Dweller Act, that is called Forest Dwellers Act. Dwellers Act. So this is giving the rights. It's all about the rights to the Forest Dwellers Act. That means who has the right to live in the jungle? and who are do not have a right to live in jungle. If they are living or staying, that means for exploiting, that is exploiting the relationship between man and environment. That is the reason. Reason samajh mein aa raha hai sabko? Okay. So this territorial zone is for the protection, and only who can exist with the nature who is living from the last, they are only permitted. Last three generations have been permitted, rest are not permitted. Okay, but rest are not permitted, but one more permission has been given. The government can give, but government in Hindu government, not the state government, please mind, not the state government, this all the national parks, not wildlife sanctuaries I'm talking about, this the central government has to permit for who can go for it, but government can permit for some developmental projects, can permit developmental like road construction, dams or railway lines can pass through it. So that, but government can permit developmental projects, even the mining projects also. That become controversial, become debatable. So now any development always have a fight or a conflict with the environmental protection. Always will be there. So no development is possible without exploiting the nature. That is 100% trust. So if you want, there's a compromise now to build up. Okay, but government can permit developmental projects, mining or tourism projects, whatever it is, or the tourism projects, whatever this is, then for that special permission is required. If permissions are not there, it is illegal. That means, suppose you want to make a house in certain ecologically sensitive zones, possible. Near, मुझे अच्छा लगता है जब तक घर बने. So it is not easy. So because of natural laws of the countries are like that, or in the world is also follows the same principles. Okay, no. So this is about where protect. So now where this principle has been applied, it's applied everywhere. It is applied first on biodiversity hotspot, the definition. So this principle is taken from where? Biodiversity hotspot only. So in the world, how many biodiversity hotspots come down? I'm just giving details. Many prelims main question comes from there. So now, how to protect, that approach is over. Now is how many and where, where this biodiversity hotspot is. You get things, this question clear? Kitne biodiversity, how many biodiversity hotspots are there? And where they are, what is the nature of it in the earth? So how many biodiversity? So you know there are in the world around 34 biodiversity hotspots has been declared. So international declaration is how many? 34 has been declared. I think 5 is under observation study. 34 is already declared. International definition. Internationally, how many has been declared? 34 across the earth, and 5 is under study actually, observation. So that means expected less in the future they might be declared. Totally depending on the study. If they find it out, okay, it is of that principle, then it will take longer time actually to study and find it out. So out of the 34, 4 is in India. You know, India is one of the richest biodiversity countries in the world. So, and there is a group internationally exists called as this biodiversity group, and 17 countries are there in that group, which is rich in what? Biodiversity. Rich in what? Biodiversity, and we are one of them among the 17 countries of the world. Earth. So there are the 17 countries in the world which have the highest biodiversity naturally found, and India is one of them. Like-minded countries which have the similar rich biodiversity, or 17 countries. So India is one of them. India is one of them from the 17 countries plus. How many out of 34 is there? 4 biodiversities in India. Biodiversity hotspot. Biodiversity hotspots are in India. So please name it all 4. 2 with the Indian name, 2 with the neighbor names. Yes. Alright, that's correct. Yeah? Sir, park park nahi hai. I am talking about bigger park. If the park is, many parks will come under that, okay? Many wildlife sanctuaries come under this concept. Western Ghats is accepted. Western Ghats is correct. One is Western Ghats, entire Western Ghats, including Sri Lanka is a part of it. Keep this point. Including Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka, do not say Sri Lanka, they call Western Ghats. Okay? So first, please remember all the 4 geographies very clearly. First is the Western Ghats. One is the what called Western Ghats of India. So India only we are talking about Western Ghats, including Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is a part of it. That means when Sri Lanka says that they have biodiversity, the hotspot S, and it is a part of extension of what? Actually, geographically, Sri Lanka is an extension of Western Ghats, nothing else. Sri Lanka is an extension of what? Western Ghats. Last point. In the southernmost point of India, what is Kanyakumari? Called what? Called Kanyakumari. And it's called Point Comorin. Actually, it is a part of this. Okay. Western Ghats including Sri Lanka. Second part. Entire Himalayas. Actually, we read old textbooks. We will find Western Himalayas only. Even the books are, those are updated, they might be referring is entire Himalayas from east to west. And it include what? Tibet, it include Pakistan, it include Bhutan, it include Nepal also. Entire Himalayas. The next is Himalayas. So even old question banks you read for UPSC, they speak of Western Himalayas or Eastern Himalayas. Or Himalayas. But answer was earlier time is Western Himalayas. Nowadays is what? Entire Himalayas. That is an update point. So this is true with the Indian name. Other Nepal, Pakistan, Bhutan all become the part of it. Of Himalayas part. Himalayas. Okay. Including now, other with the we share biodiversity hotspot, but not with Indian name. It come from neighbor name. Vice versa. So that there is a controversy on people confusion, students are confused. How many biodiversity India have? Answer is actually 2 with the Indian names and prominences and 2 with the neighboring names. So one is, third is called Indo-Burma region. Third is called Indo-Burma hotspot. First is called Western Ghats hotspot, which includes Sri Lanka. Second called Himalaya hotspot. Third is called Indo-Burma hotspot. So entire northeast of India is a part of it. The northeast part of India belongs to what? Indo-Myanmar biodiversity hotspot. But major focus is to Southeast Asia here. But Indian, which location? Northeastern states of India is a part of it. Fourth, batayega koi koshish karega. Sundarban is not, okay. Sundarban is a different thing. Great Barrier Reef, Australia mein. Great Barrier Reef is in Australia. Somewhat is there, he is nearby but is using different name. But I, okay. You know, with Great Nicobar Island is there, okay. Which island? Nicobar Islands are there, Andaman Nicobar Islands. So great is somewhat I understood, but बैरियर रीफ पहुंच गए आप लोग ऑस्ट्रेलिया में. And now, this is with Indonesian name, what is called? The Sumatra Island, isn't it or not? Okay, this is called Sunda or also called this, or Sumatra or, right on the fourth is called as Sunda Hotspot. Which? Sunda Hotspot. Sunda or Sumatra Hotspot. Sunda. Sunda is what? Sunda is a location where? Sunda is here. And this Sumatra and all this up to this. So it is belongs to actually Indonesia. Belongs to what called? Indonesia. So it is extended up to what? Which part of India? Andaman Nicobar Island. Andaman Nicobar. Especially the Great Nicobar. Not the Andaman Wala part. इससे इसको चला दो, उसको बंद कर दो, ठंडा लग रहा है लोगों को. ऑलवेज इन एवरी क्लास इज अ बिग प्रॉब्लम, यू नो दोज वर सिटिंग जस्ट बीनीथ द और नियर टू द एसी ना, अरे अब वो ठंडा गर्म बिकॉज दे डायरेक्ट बर्स्ट इज ऑन देम. तो ओके इंडोनेशिया नो लिव लिव ऑन इंडोनेशिया इज सुंदर रीजन, सुमात्रा रीजन. विच रीजन? ऑल्सो कॉल्ड सुमात्रा रीजन. सुमात्रा region and here Andaman Nicobar Islands is a part of it. Okay, cleared or not? And it's called Great Nicobar of India. Great Nicobar, especially the Great Nicobar or Island of India. So next is called Great Nicobar Island of India. Is everyone clear? So how many parts? Four parts. So two parts no problem. But problem is these people get confused. So that Great Nicobar Islands of India is a extension of what called Sumatra region of hotspot. Or the northeast part of India is an extension of Indo-Burma region. Okay, this is one. Four hotspots are biodiversity hotspots are in India. Apart from this, in the world, what are the ecological characteristics? Or where all 34 are there? If you want to see, first is mountain, Mediterranean. Just I'm giving a hint. Others are found in specialized ecosystems. Specialized ecosystems only. The richest in the biodiversity generally. Richest in what called biodiversity. They are found in some specialized ecosystems. One is the mountainous region. First is in which region? Mountainous regions are there, you will find many species. Where are mountain ranges are there together, or highlands are there, that has a rich biodiversity. This is one point. Like Himalayas or Western Ghats or everywhere in the world like this. Like Alps Mountain, like if the Rockies Mountains or the Andes Mountains, all are what? Hotspot. Is it clear? Andes, Rockies, Alps, all become the part of it. Or the mountains of Central Asia or anywhere in the world. That's the one which is. Second geography is the Mediterranean climatic regions. Second richest part is what called specialized under Mediterranean regions. Second region is what called Mediterranean regions. You know of 5-6 locations on the earth which called Mediterranean climatic regions are there. Yesterday also we have seen. So all is a part of it. All is a part of Mediterranean region. So that is also third part is especially the coastal ecosystem, especially where mangroves or space or we call the coral reefs are found together. Which reef? Coral reef region. Okay. Coral reef region. Coral reef region is richest part. Okay. So these are the three, even some equatorial regions too, mountainous region, Mediterranean region, coral reef in the marine ecosystem. This is representing which ecosystem? Marine ecosystem basically. And one on the land part is in the monsoonal climate. Next is also in the thick dense monsoonal climates also found. So there are two types of monsoon. One is the dry monsoon, second is called wet monsoon, especially the wet monsoonal region, where rainfall is more than 150 or centimeters around that. Wet monsoonal climate where rainfall pattern is more than 150, that the biodiversity is very different. All the 34 you can find in here only, nowhere else. All in the world, if you find out, like I said, okay, floristic region of California. Example is what called? Example I said, floristic region of California. So you know California lies under which ecosystem? Come on. Remember from yesterday's point. So Mediterranean. California coast is what? Mediterranean. Like that. Or the coastal areas are Mediterranean. So that is belongs to this part. If I said Andaman, Great Nicobars or Sumatra or what, all this is what? Coral geography. Especially. Even Himalayas and Western Ghats is what? This. So all even Indo-Burma region or Southeast Asian part, it's what? Monsoonal climate. Is it getting clear? So all is a part of it. Rich ecosystem. Note one thing. And if whatever the list we will get, all the list is available, whatever the material is supplied, it is there in the name. All 34 you learn. And all become important for prelims. And this topic is very important. All 34, on internet also you can Google it and find it out. Even there are many textbooks are available, or you can take it from there. Even on internet, you Google it out, you can download directly. There are many ways of identifying the information. Okay, apart from this hotspot, so there are two types of conservational approaches, biodiversity conservational approaches are being grouped. Biodiversity, what? Conservational approach. How to protect and conserve? Approaches are two types. One protects their own, called in situ conservation approach. In situ approach, right, their own. That means protecting the species in the natural habitat, in the natural region. So their own, that, right, in situ means what? Protecting the species, plants and animals their own. That means in the natural conditions. Protecting in the natural conditions. So for involved, we did one called biodiversity. On the world level we call what? Biodiversity hotspot. That is the world concept. Second, even we are declaring by wetlands. We are declaring what called? Another thing, at international level we are also declaring what called? At international level, we are declaring two things. That is, one is called biodiversity hotspot. Second, we are declaring what called, and that is called Ramsar Convention. Which convention? Ramsar under convention. It is not part of UN, please. First is a part of, people get wrong here. Biodiversity hotspot is a part of what? UN, correct. But second, wetland conservation, it's an ecosystem and work on these approaches only. But it is not a under UN. It is the Ramsar Convention separate intergovernment approaches there. It is apart from the Ramsar Convention is intergovernmental right. Intergovernmental approach. Many nations are coming together, forming a group. That group is called what? The group find a treaty called Ramsar Convention to protect wetland. To protect what called? So under wetland we will see in detail. So all the lakes, man-made or natural, all the coastal mangroves and all come under what? Wetland. That's what I said top here. There's a different, that's not biodiversity hotspot, there's a new concept called wetland. Ramsar is a place in Iran. So this word is on the lake. Ramsar is a place in which country? Iran. From that the word has been taken. Ramsar first international convention happened to protect lakes, natural or the man-made, or the ecosystem. This is very important. So this is two. Next is, okay, this is the two things. Apart from that, at national, international level, this happened. National level, using these two concepts, declaring what? National parks, at national level, wildlife, right, all this are there. Wildlife sanctuaries, or anything? National park, wildlife sanctuaries, or zoological gardens, whatever you call it. National park, wildlife sanctuaries, even any natural forest areas, whatever you call it. All ecosystems is a part of it. Or bird conservation project. All bird conservation is overlapping with what? Wetlands. Bird conservation or species conservation. So whenever species conservation is there, it is overlapping with national park and wildlife sanctuaries. Like you make tiger reserves, elephant reserves, or any other kind of any particular species in a natural habitat, that is a part of it. It's called natural condition there. Species conservation project. Any species in India, around 11 to 12 species are specially protected. Tiger is more important. Okay, now this approach of called in situ with natural condition. Second approach you have to is right. Ex situ approach. Second approach is what called ex situ approach. So that means here plant and animal is not protected the natural conditions, not possible. It is approaching outside the natural condition. Protection is outside the natural conditions or natural habitat. Outside the natural habitat. How to do? And any activity is done outside to protect and conserve them that come under that. Any activity is done. So, kya karoge bhai? What should be done? Kya karna chahiye? So, what should be done? So, okay, you make zoos, zoological, okay na, zoo vagera, zoological gardens, right, zoological gardens, botanical gardens, they're not a natural condition. You can mix plants, animals, and put it from anywhere and put it, and conserving them. Okay, or even called gene bank, seed bank, all these are there, no? You're preserving genes. You heard of gene banks? This comes. Okay. Even nowadays, human genes are being preserved. But they have to go. Chennai is become the hotspot of preserving and conserving the human gene. And for what purpose? Stem cells taken and any in the future any disease happen to children, they will take from the genes and develop a new organ and will be transplanted in the future. That's a point. It's accidental cases. Gene bank. Chennai is the headquarter for India, if you think, for the gene bank. For a human point of view. Do not write about any plant, I mean here. Any plant or animal's gene bank. Okay? Okay, seed bank. Next is called what? Okay, which is the largest, biggest seed bank on the earth? It's very important. And it's written in the news. Okay, Savalbird seed vault, you heard of? कभी सुना है पढ़ा है नहीं पढ़ा है इट इज इन दी अंडर द स्नो एंड इज वर्ल्ड लार्जेस्ट सीड बैंक ऑन द अर्थ एंड इट इज इंटरनेशनल फ्रॉम एवरीवेयर द सीड हैज बीन प्रिजर्व कंजर्व एंड डेवलप्ड बिकॉज ऑफ क्लाइमेट चेंज एंड लॉस ऑफ बायोडायवर्सिटी फ्यूचर जनरेशन has been preserved. From India also many species of all the crops has been put there. So even Savalbird is here. You know this island? It's an island called Savalbird Island. Belongs to Norway. Belongs to what? Which country? And in the Arctic, the island is there that has been preserved and it's called Svalbard. You understood this location? Called Svalbard. The bank is there, the world largest bank. Under the snows or the glaciers it's been protected. So if anything wrong, if any all these plants and the agriculture crops are destroyed, so then what to do? Then humanity is under danger, then how to protect it? Regenerate that. Answer is just this will be preserved and they will use it again. So it's a good human activity actually, I'm calling it very good. For the food security point of view. Any countries are some species are lost, they can take that, regenerate in the labs and new species could be generated. So, okay, zoological gardens, botanical gardens, gene banks, seed banks, even call aquariums are there. Now, okay. You heard of aquariums? Big aquariums has been built up under the sea. Even this, all museums, okay, zoological museums and all even all you can think of. Okay. So all called ex situ approaches. So sometime in the prelims might be asked, they will give you the method. So which come under which approaches? They will identify that approach. Okay, samajh mein aa gaya? Okay, now. Now, one question arises here at the national level in this approach, difference between three words. Okay. One is called biosphere reserve. Okay, that word I have forgotten now. Biosphere reserve. Next, national park. That is the wildlife. Centuries from the Indian point of view. So, what is the point of difference between the three in situ conservation approach at the national level? So all are in situ conservation approaches: biosphere reserves, national park, and the wildlife centuries. So, what is the point of difference? Generally, biosphere reserves into two or more national parks or wildlife sanctuaries, and it works the same principle as biodiversity hotspot. Try to understand. It works on the same principle of what called biodiversity hotspot. That means this part is core. This is what? Right, buffer zone, and this is called transitional zone. Right, transitional or territory. Transitional or also called what? Territorial zone. Transitional or also called territorial zone. So they work on this principle, and geographical this part is what? Large landscape. And involve two or three, involve what? Two or more national parks or wildlife centuries. So this area is more. So why it has been declared? Question is why it has been declared in the country? We want this to be get funded by from UN or international bodies to get the money from outside in the name of protection and conservation or for the sustainable development or carbon sink and all kind of things. What that we are declaring. And not only we, in every country is declaring. So this approach is to get fund from the UN body. To get fund from what is the aim? To get fund from what called UN or other international bodies. Okay. To do this, how many biosphere reserves we have declared till now. Kitna kiya? 18. How many? 18 biosphere reserves we have declared till now. How many in the country? 18. 18 biosphere reserves. Out of 18, now we declared, we want that UN should accept. Okay. But that body of UN called UNESCO. That body of UN is called what? Body of UN is called what? UNESCO's, the fund comes from the which body of UN? Called UNESCO, the fund comes here. In the name of protection and conservation. So we want that UNESCO should accept it and put under the natural heritage list and protect it. And that's called, that's what we are declaring what? Biosphere reserves. So how many we have declared? 18. Out of 18, 9 is already we are able to fulfill. We want all 18 should be there. Once 18 is there, we have 20 more. Process continues. So you are getting. So how many biosphere reserves? 18. Now write the name for delivering all the names. And all are again important. First is first four. Biodiversity hotspot done. Now is next what called? 18 biosphere reserves. This is name. First declared was just coming from Nilgiris. First biosphere reserve declared in India was which one? Nilgiris biosphere reserve. Nilgiris biosphere reserve, how many states? Nilgiris kidhar hai? You know near Uti. Now three states. Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. Alright, Nilgiri biosphere reserve. All the three states. Just write on the names of this. Other part we cannot do today, only the names I can do. Nilgiris means all the three states. Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and the Kerala. And the Kerala. All the three states are there. Many wildlife sanctuary national parks is a part of it. The first declared in the country was Nilgiris. Okay. And in the last declared in India is called Panna biosphere. And rest of that is the last declared is, I think, 2-3 years back, 2013, I think, declared. No, 15, I think. 2 years back, 15. Called Panna Biosphere Reserve in Madhya Pradesh. Panna. Panna, P-A-N-N-A. Panna Biosphere Reserve. Where? Which state? Madhya Pradesh. And that stopped, you know, once it is declared, first interlinking project of India was being stopped by this declaration, you know. What is the first interlinking river water projects in the, as per this project of 37 link canal or 30 link canal project? Kane Betwa link canal. Which link canal? Kane. That didn't stop. And from this government reinitiated it. And okay, now leave this part. Now rest of the how many are left out? 16. So now any order you can put it down. And we follow geography. We follow the geography. First is called Great Nicobar. South to north we are moving. You can remember this. Great Nicobar. That is in Andaman Nicobar. Great Nicobar. Next is Agastyamalai in Kerala. Agastyamalai. Which state? In Kerala. That is in the coastal part here. Near Ernakulam and all places. Agastyamalai is a biosphere reserve declared. Now if you move further upward, you enter into Madhya Pradesh. Madhya Pradesh has three. How many? Biosphere reserves? Three. And the largest forest area in the country is which state? MP. In terms of geographical pointers. So write down other two. One is already covered. Two is Pachmadi. One is what called Pachmadi Biosphere Reserve. It is under UNESCO list. Pachmadi just is a mountain there. Pachmadi is there. So PNC, Pachmadi is in MP. Next is, it's a bordering with Chhattisgarh. Bordering with what called? Chhattisgarh, Amarkantak, remember? Amarkantak, Achnakmar. The complete name is Achnakmar. Two is part region. This is a biosphere. Together, it's not one. So right on both the states, MP plus Chhattisgarh. Amarkantak, Achnakmar. A-C-H, Achnakmar. A-C-H-N-A-K-M-A-R. Achnakmar. Okay, what are the two states? MP and Chhattisgarh. Now coming to Gujarat. Gujarat, India's largest biosphere reserve is there called what? Run of Kutch. Run of Kutch is what? Is it? Right, Run of Kutch. Biosphere. Largest Run of Kutch is a biosphere completely declared. There are two runs, you know. If you look at this Gujarat, not run of Kutch, how many run are there? Two. Little run and great run. So run of Kutch. So only written run of Kutch. Largest biosphere river in terms of geographical area is this one. Largest. In the state of Gujarat. Run of Kutch, this entire part. Okay, now coming to this part, Odisha. Next part is coming to Andhra Pradesh. Okay, Seshachalam is Telangana or Andhra Pradesh? Okay, right. Seshachalam is a peak, very important one. Seshachalam is in Andhra Pradesh. This is also a biosphere reserve. Seshachalam is also a biosphere reserve, AP. Andhra Pradesh. Now we are moving further. And now enters into Odisha having one called Simplipal. Simplipal, which state? Odisha. Okay, Simplipal is there in Odisha. Next one. Now here we enter into Odisha now. After Odisha is Bengal. So which one? Sundarban. Isn't it not? Sundarban is a biosphere reserve. Sundarban Delta. Which region? Sundarban Delta. Which state? West Bengal. Even it is shared with somewhat with the. Okay. Now we enter further Assam. Now entering into what called Assam Manas Biosphere Reserve. Manas, M-A-N-S. Manas Biosphere Reserve. Manas Biosphere Reserve. Which state? Assam. Okay, Nokrek. Next is Nokrek. Nokrek. Which state? Meghalaya. Nokrek Biosphere Reserve in which state? Meghalaya. Next is incident. Which is the highest peak of Himalayas in India? Here to Himalayas mein. That is in Karakoram range. Which one? Bahut badhiya. Bahut badhiya. All these peaks you are telling, which is highest of India, that's correct. I'm 100% correct. But question is not highest of Indian Himalayas. Okay? Number one. And it is not a Himalayas. It's called Trans-Himalayas or Tibet Karakoram range. Karakoram is not part of three ranges of Himalayas. Wrong. Okay. Kanchenjunga. Indian highest peak in Himalayas is what? Kanchenjunga and Sikkim. Okay? So Kanchenjunga is right on there. Okay. Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve, Sikkim. Okay, how many you have written? 13 you have written? Next, Dibru Chukwa. That is in again Assam. Dibru Chukwa is again in Assam. Next, Dibang. That is in Arunachal Pradesh. Which state? Arunachal Pradesh. That is in the state of Arunachal
प्रदेश
तो
आज 15 और कितना हो गया.
ओके नाउ कम टू दिस पार्ट
हिमालयन पार्ट
उत्तराखंड
कम टू व्हाट कॉल
उत्तराखंड. तो नंदा देवी
तो नंदा देवी इज अ बायोस्फीयर रिजर्व स्टेट.
ओके राइट उत्तराखंड. नेक्स्ट इज वन मोर इज देयर in the called cold desert.
One is called what called cold desert.
Cold desert is a biosphere of name is cold desert, that is in Himachal Pradesh
state. Cold desert biosphere reserve is in the state of what called Himachal Pradesh. Okay next how many.
Okay, one is in the water body, Gulf of Mannar.
One is in the water body called as what? Gulf of Mannar. It is in Gulf of Mannar. Gulf of Mannar, you know this part.
Right.
State of Tamil Nadu and Kerala.
Yes.
Okay. It's mainly in the Tamil Nadu part, mainly it's state of Tamil Nadu coast. So this become A. And find out from your own how, so which are under which list?
UNESCO list. 9 are under the UNESCO list.
Okay, thank you for today.